So I read 100 Years of Solitude and The Ottoman Patriarch, both by Gabriel Garcia Marquez. And so in my SSR project, I also had a little author study, which was really interesting, especially because my topic was American influence in Latin America and some of the things that we have done and how it's changed the culture and the people. So I'm kind of going to jump around between my two books because I think it's really interesting because they both looked at kind of the same thing but through different eyes. 100 Years of Solitude is through the eyes of the people, and it kind of follows the Buendia family as through a few different generations. And you see the changes that come into the small, kind of secluded town as time goes on. And The Autumn of the Patriarch is actually written through the eyes of the dictator himself, and was actually put in power by the United States. So it's kind of interesting, especially because The Autumn of the Patriarch was based on a lot of factual things in Latin America. There isn't a specific country that he ever talks about in the book. It's more of a collection of things, so we'll get to that too. First of all is the influence of war and what it has done and what the United States has done in Latin America. In both, we see the war between the liberals and the conservatives, because that goes on all the time. And there really isn't a stable, in both books, there isn't a stable government, and it changes hands a lot. So war isn't as big in 100 Years of Solitude, even though it does deal a lot with it, but in The Autumn of the Patriarch, the war is the reason that the dictator in the book is set up. There's a really, really bloody clash between the liberals and the conservatives, and so finally the United States decides to step in and say, no, we're ending this. So the Marines are sent, and they're, we'll get to that in the flow chart too, the Marines are sent in, and they actually set up this dictator, which we did in Nicaragua, and we've done in other places as well. The book was actually, Marquez was inspired by Castro and the Cuban Revolution a lot, so you see a lot of factual things in the book. And then another major influence, too, that we see in Latin America is the Christian church. And the church is set up in Macondo, which is the town in 100 Years of Solitude. And that's kind of the first root there of American, like the outsiders. And the church is set up in the country where our dictator is set, which there isn't a specific country, but he deals a lot with the church. And it's kind of interesting because there is no point where he doesn't ever say, like, he doesn't like the church, he isn't a Christian, he doesn't really deal with that kind of stuff. But through the whole book, you kind of see him become a Christ figure. He and his mother are very, like, he's fatherless, he's born without a future because he doesn't have lines on his hands, and he's destined to become king. And there's this, every time he refers to his mother, it's like, oh, holy mother of mine, oh, my good mother. And so it's just really, like, interesting how that's kind of worked in there. But he actually tries to throw the church out in order to regain control of this country, because after he's set up by the Marines, it's all madness. And basically they say, good luck, buddy, bye, see ya. And so he tries to throw off the church, which may or may not have been a good decision, because eventually they just trickle back in anyways. And once the church obviously takes root in your country, you can't throw everyone out. But he did, and it didn't work very well. But I think it's really interesting that you see something as old as the church, and because it was in Latin America from the time the Spanish came and brought it over. So you see that it's still influencing the politics and the way people run their lives. Another thing that we see is both countries, or both different places in the books, we see them slip into a decline. And the decline in 100 Years of Solitude comes after the banana plantation comes. The banana plantation is run by American workers, and because after the railroad comes through, they realize that this would be a great place for us to harvest bananas. So they come in and they exploit the workers, and there's a big strike because people want fair working conditions. They want nice bathrooms, they don't want to have to work all the time, and they bet the workers back up themselves to get the strike back, to end the strike with the military. So the military comes in and they massacre over 2,000 people, and the people are loaded on a train and just dumped into the sea, which is similar to what happens in The Autumn of the Patriarch, when the general has a whole bunch of children put on a boat and sent out into the Caribbean, and the boat explodes and the kids all die. So I think it's interesting that you see terrible things like that happen, and then they slip into this decline after the death of all of these people. And then the problem with the government in both countries is it's very unstable. It always changes hands between the conservatives and the liberals. You never really know who's in charge or who they're going to use to back up their laws. With the dictator in the Ottoman of the Patriarch, part of his problem is he never wanted to be the dictator. He never wanted the power, but when the Marines came, he was a general in the army, and so they put him in charge of everything. And he never actually gets to do anything because all the people below him are plotting against him and they're trying to murder people. And so he kind of starts to lose his mind. And at the end, there's this really graphic scene where all of his like heads of, you know, the War Department and the State Department, they're all meeting for dinner at his house. And he knew that his longtime friend, who's in charge of the War Department, was plotting to head up the plot to kill him at his state dinner. And so everyone was waiting, and they're all kind of like sitting waiting, like, okay, where is he? And the general has him rolled out on a platter, and he's cooked and he's served. So you see, he starts to lose his mind. And he never gets to actually run his own country because these people are always doing terrible things beneath him. And then we see the final decline, like I said, with 100 years of solitude, when the bodies are dumped into the ocean. Well, that causes this colossal rain that lasts for, I don't remember how many years it was, 10 years. And then it all just kind of dries up. And then there's this drought and things are like blowing away because they're just dust. It's blowing away, and then the apocalypse comes and everything just kind of wipes out. Well, you see something similar to that in the Ottoman of the Patriarch, when he gets so desperate because their country is in such terrible shape that they have no money, and the United States is starting to put pressure on them to pay back some of their debts. And so he literally sells the sea. And what they do is America sends their nautical engineers, and they literally divide up the sea in pieces and carry it away. So similarly, their country just kind of dries up and floats away too, and they are set in this drought, and then the old dictator dies. And what's really interesting about the sea connection is between the both books, the sea was really, they talked about it a lot in 100 Years of Solitude, but they could never find it. And as the founders were setting out to go establish their new town, which eventually became Mekano, they were talking about, they found the ship. They were like, how did the ship get here? It's in the middle of land. Which is interesting because in the Ottoman of the Patriarch, when they sell the sea and take the sea away, there's this shipwreck that he goes and explores that's on the bottom of what used to be the sea. So that's really interesting. And I think that shows the importance of the sea and how we trade across it and who owns it and who owns the power in Latin America and how that has influenced their economies and their politics. One thing he does between his two books, too, is the way he skews time. If you haven't read 100 Years of Solitude, I always recommend it. It's a really good book. But the time is really, really weird. Like, four generations seems to span, like, I think it's like 300 years if you kind of look at it, because it's like from the time before any technology, and then you have telephones, and you get to the railroads and things like that. Which is also really interesting in the Ottoman of the Patriarch, because there are some flashbacks from when he's an infant. He'll flashback and kind of talk about being with his mother and how he was raised. But there's never an in-between. He's always an old man. He was an old man when he was married. He was an old man when he became the dictator. And he stays the old man for several comets. They talk about it as, I would assume it's Halley's Comet, because most people only see one. Maybe the lucky ones get to see two in their lifetime if they see them when they're very young. But he survives three or four comet cycles. And I think that is kind of his representation of how these things have been happening for a very long time, and they will continue to happen. Because this dictator isn't a real dictator, he's just the symbol of the collective power and how things are run in various Latin American countries. So I have this flowchart to go with mine, because I think it's really interesting, and once you start the cycle, it's really hard for anyone to get out of the cycle. And that's why we see a lot of impoverished nations and things like that. And often it starts with the church. We see that. We also saw that in Things Fall Apart and a lot of other things that we've worked with. So then we spread. We branch out two different directions from this. We have colonization and exploitation, which would be the banana plantation that we saw. We go in and we use them. We use them for their natural resources, for their land. And with that, we always bring our government, because if we're going to have things there, then somehow we have to be able to manage them. We have to be able to manage the people. And from there, we move on, we exploit the people, and we send in the military to back up our decisions. And this often starts conflict as much as it ends conflict. So we see things like the war, the violence. We set up rulers. I have Fidel Castro there. And that's exactly like what we did in Nicaragua. They had their conflict between the liberals and the conservatives, and we ended it and we set up their dictator, which is exactly what happens in the Ottoman Patriarch. So we set up our rulers. Eventually, it all kind of leads to the poverty, the violence. As we do this, we destroy culture, we take away original values, because everything changes. And when we start to see the culture come out, our culture go in, creates instability, which eventually leads to collapse again, and then we start the cycle over, because someone has to go in and fix things. So that's what I looked at.
I'm so happy that there's a source for the book.